stopped raining for days. My world is a flood, but slowly I become one with the mud.
But if I can't swim after 40 days, and my mind is crushed by the crashing waves that feel so high that I cannot fall, lift me up, whoa. Lift me up
when I'm falling.
Lift me up
when we can die. Splashing in the ocean, I'm losing control. Dark sky all around, can't feel my feet touching the ground.
But if I can't swim out the fall,
dry the stream still flowing, casting down all ways and sin and guilt that overthrow me.
Lift me up
when I'm falling.
Lift me up
when we can die.
why you ever chose me. It's always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line, with all the other night quiets, with all that never get it right. But it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody to save my soul. Ever since you rescued me, gave my heart a song to sing, living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus, living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus.
Moses had a stage fright. David brought a rock to a sword fight. You picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Well, the moral of the story is everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me saying, who do you think you are?
I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing, living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus, living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus.
I may go down, down, down in history as another butler, faithful member of the family. And if they all find me, I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history.
In history.
Another blood, a faithful member of the family.
It's all I ever want to be.
If they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing, living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus, living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus, living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
Amen. Welcome to Agape Christian Church. We are so glad that you have come to worship with us on Resurrection Sunday and celebrate the fact that our Savior is risen. He is risen indeed today. We have just a couple, one announcement and a couple thank yous. So first of all, make sure that you grab one of these downstairs. This is called the Glow Party. This is going to be a family event on April 13th. This is for kids and parents. There's stuff for both of us, both kids and parents, to do. Make sure you grab one of these downstairs. And if you have questions about it, you can direct them to Taylor or to Teresa. And it's going to be a big blessing to families. So make sure that you grab one of these and come if you can. Couple of thank yous we need to make today. First of all, everyone who helped out with the breakfast and helped make the breakfast. Thank you. What a wonderful thing. And Daisy wanted me to make sure to say thank you to all those who helped clean up. We were completely cleaned up before service even started, which is unheard of. So thank you so much to everyone who helped clean up. The other big thank you that we have today, the lift that we have been working on for a long time is finally done and ready. We have four guys to thank for that. First of all, Ted Phillips worked tirelessly. Brian Smith and Dennis Smith and then John Cudney. Those four guys, they worked tirelessly to make sure that thing is in right and works, and we passed inspection this week and we're good to go. So thank you to those guys for all your hard work and talent. So the biggest thank you we have today is for our Lord and Savior, who sacrificed himself on the cross for us. And that's why we're here to celebrate. That's why we're here to worship today. So will you pray with me as we continue our service? Lord, we are so thankful today. Lord, we are thankful every day for what you did for us on the cross. Lord, today as we remember the day that you walked out of the grave, conquered sin and death for us, we are so thankful, Lord. We have a hope that nothing can take away in this world. And that's all because of you and your love for us and what you have done. Lord, we are so thankful for you, and we ask that you would be among us and be honored and glorified as we worship you today. It's all in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Come all you thirsty, come to the well.
sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings,
who shakes the whole
earth, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in His place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
We shout out your praise. And He rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in His place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
Amen. If you could please have a seat while you're shouting, that would be fabulous. It's so great to have you all here today. We have been collecting for the last couple of months what we call our Easter offering. This year's Easter offering goes to a wonderful mission here in LaPorte called the Women's... Women's Care Center, the Women's Care Center, and they are moving locations, not only for a bigger building, but also an area that works a little better for them, a little bit more public, so more people can be blessed by them on Lincoln Way. So we are giving towards that. We're also going to be helping them build it, so if you want to help, please call or text me, and I will get you involved. But thank you so much for that offering. So far, we have raised a little over $1,900, so thank you so much for that. And those jars in the back and the offering plates, if you write it specifically, will be open for the rest of the day, and then we're done with that. Thank you so much for blessing the Women's Care Center and this community. We're going to pray for offering and keep worshiping together. Thank you so much for being here, everyone. Dear God, thank you for this amazing day. Thank you for this time that we can just be with you. I was just speaking to someone and I asked them, how are you doing? And they said, my family's here, I'm happy. And I thought for a second that if we accept Christ, we've been baptized into a new family, your family, and you're an amazing, awesome God who can do anything. But if someone asked you, how you doing, God? Your answer would be, my family's here, I'm happy. And so the fact that I, who have a lot of growing to do, can make God happy because I'm part of his family, that's incredible love. Please help us remember his incredible love during our offering time, but also during our communion time. Help us just sit in the fact that we serve a God who deeply loves that we are here and we are his. Please help us honor him with our life. Help us always remember that we are cherished, we are loved, and we are awesome in God's eyes. Wow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
One day when heaven is filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. Word became flesh and light shined among us, glory revealed. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified me freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Glory. my sins far away. Rising justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day, oh glorious day. I see the sun coming up in the sky. I see the star in the still of the night. I see you are.
When I feel the breath of the wind on my face, a rest in the arms of a father's embrace. I feel who you are.
Who you are is all I ever want to be. Me. As you're constantly changing my heart, leading me out of the dark, bringing me closer to who you are.
Ready to love, ready to dance,
live every moment.
John Konecrum is going to help get our hearts prepared for communion this morning. Morning, Tammy.
He is risen. That's the best news ever. So I've entitled my meditation this morning, more than expected. Interestingly, I talked to another person that does community meditations, and these things change minute by minute. So what I have written here may not be what I say. God has a way to do that. So many of you know that Gail and I like to hike and camp, and I like to backpack. Several years ago, a friend of ours said, hey, you should sign up for this thing called Cairn, spelled like the little stack of rocks. And so I looked into it, and you can get a subscription for a year, or you can pay monthly, or there's a bunch of different things that you can do with that. But they send you a box once a month that has stuff that you can trial and say, hey, this is good, not so good. Gail and I would always wait for each other to open that box because it would be like Christmas once a month. We did that for a couple of years. And sometimes those things are pretty lame. And sometimes they're pretty amazing. So a trail bar that is made from crickets, it didn't taste that bad, but it was really expensive and really crickets. Give me chocolate. The first item, or the first box that we opened, it had an item in there. It was about this long, and it opened up to be looking like a radio antenna, just from a little transistor radio kind of thing. And that went in the junk box right away, the junk pile. A little micro bellows that's going to help you start fires. A couple of weeks later, I'm having the grandkids over. We're having the grandkids over for a weenie roast, and it had rained for several days before, and so the wood was really challenging to get lit. And so I'm almost running out of newspaper, and I remembered, hey, there's something in the junk box. Let me try that. And sure enough, within a few minutes, the fire was going. And within a few more minutes after that, it was raging and ready for s'mores and hot dogs. That little gadget goes with me when I go hiking every time. It is amazing, just more than I'd expected. And if I would have left it in the box, it would have just been a little old radio antenna that I would have never used. But I took it out and took a chance and was amazed. Today we celebrate the death and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ because he took our sins on himself, died, paid the price, and then rose again in 3 days. We have forgiveness of sins, and we have the assurance of everlasting life in heaven where there'll be no more pain, no more suffering. But if we just stop there, we miss so much. While that's the best news ever, if you take him out of the box and live with him every day, we gain forgiveness of our sins. We get the power of that forgiveness, which removes the guilt and shame that's associated with our sins. Our sin is removed as far as the east is from the west. But that's not all. We gain understanding and wisdom through the Holy Spirit that can live in us. If those things aren't enough, as the song says, the same power that rose Jesus from the grave lives in us. Think about that for a minute. That's huge. Has anybody raised anybody from the dead here? If you have, I'm going to be really impressed and scared. But Jesus did that for us, and we have that same power. So, during this time of communion, please meditate on the incredible sacrifice that Jesus made through his amazing power because of his willingness to pay the price for our sin. Commit today to grow closer to him by prayer, studying his word, meditating on his word, practicing the spiritual disciplines. It is more than we ever could expect or could ever imagine. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that you have touched our hearts and our lives. Please help us to be very connected to you. Help us to study your word. Help us to appreciate the true sacrifice that you made for us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
When I was a kid, I spent a lot of my free time either outside with a BB gun or in the garage, either making things or sometimes taking things apart that I may or may not have had permission to take apart. But spending my time that way led to a lot of cuts and scrapes, some worse than others. I have a few pretty decent scars that all have a story behind them. My dad was the first aid guy in our family, and so between what he taught me and all the things that he did when he was taking care of me and what I learned in Boy Scouts, I ended up being pretty capable in most of, let's call them, first aid situations. My dad would make homemade butterfly bandages. I used my fair share of super glue and creative bandaging. I've never actually had stitches until I was in my 30s. Several times I probably should have, and I just made do with a Band-Aid instead. About 7 years ago, right before we moved to La Porte, I had just sharpened our mower blades. I was putting them back on, and I remember thinking, you know, I probably should have put on a pair of gloves in case this wrench slips, and that was about a half a second before the wrench slipped, and my left hand went into the freshly sharpened blade. I looked down, and I saw more of the inside of my hand than I had ever seen before, and I knew it was more than my first aid skills could handle. It was more than a Band-Aid type of situation. I needed a professional to take care of that. Over the last several weeks, we've been looking at the signs or the miracles that John wrote about in his gospel that Jesus performed. John gives us a lot fewer miracles than the other gospels do, but each one of the ones that John chose to write about is not meant to just tell us a story, but to show us who Jesus is and what he was here to do for us. Through these signs, John shows us all kinds of things about Jesus. John shows us that Jesus was going to become the new way that we would be purified and made clean instead of the old ways of the Jewish law. He shows us the compassion and care that Jesus had for those who needed healing, not just physically, but also spiritually as well. He shows us that sometimes those who seem like they have it all together and know what they're talking about really don't, that they're really blind to Jesus. And that those you don't expect are sometimes the ones who see Jesus for who he really is. And when he tells us about Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead, John gives us a picture of what Jesus was going to do to bring about redemption and new life for all those who would believe in him. All those signs culminate in the final sign, the final miracle that John writes about in his gospel, the reason that we celebrate Easter every year, the resurrection of Jesus. When John tells us about the resurrection, it wasn't just John telling us about who Jesus is and what he was going to do. He makes it clear that the death and resurrection of Jesus is what he has been building up to all this time. This was the reason Jesus came to earth to begin with. In Matthew 20, Jesus said, "The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." Everything else Jesus did while he was here was to give us a picture of what he was going to do on this day and how to become a part of his kingdom. But the sacrifice Jesus made for us on the cross was Jesus' mission all along. He never let anything stop him from completing that mission. We see the beginning of his drive to make sure that he completed that mission in Luke chapter 9. He says, when the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. Jesus was determined to go to Jerusalem, knowing all that would happen to him so that he could offer himself as a sacrifice that he came into the world to be for us. We needed someone to be a sacrifice for us on our behalf because of our sin. The Bible is clear that God is not only perfectly holy and righteous, but he is also perfectly just, which means that he could not allow sin to go unpunished. It's a part of God's nature that sin had to be dealt with. And so a big part of the ceremonies and the rituals of the Jewish people were all based around the animals that were sacrificed to atone for the people and their sin. The sacrifices that were made every single day in the temple, they were a temporary covering, a temporary fix for the sin of humanity. Those sacrifices were a Band-Aid that might help for a little while, but they would never fix the real problem. The problem of the sin of humanity was not a temporary problem, and so sacrifices had to be offered over and over and over again. That all changed when Jesus came and he offered his own life for us instead. In Hebrews chapter 10, it says in verse 12, "But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us. For after saying, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord, I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds. Then he adds, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. And so because of what Jesus did for us on the cross, there's no longer any need for other sacrifices. The sacrifice he made for us was more than enough for all the sin of humanity, past, present, and future. His death on the cross also ushered in that new covenant that Hebrews talks about, where we are not just putting a Band-Aid on a problem that could never be solved that way. When we enter into this new covenant, we are forgiven of our sin, and they are not remembered by God any longer. That's what happens when we believe in Jesus and we follow after him. Jesus is the only thing that we need, the only thing that can bring us the forgiveness that we need. Anything else is just a Band-Aid that will never really solve the problem of sin that we have. But Jesus' sacrifice is not just a Band-Aid. The grace and forgiveness Jesus offers us through his sacrifice on the cross is the complete and permanent solution to our sin. But when Jesus went to the cross as our sacrifice, he did something that no other sacrifice before him could do. Jesus not only sacrificed his life for us to conquer our sin and bring us forgiveness, Jesus didn't just bring us forgiveness, he brought us new life. Jesus was betrayed by Judas, one of his disciples. He was arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane. He was given false trials by both the Jews and the Romans. He was beaten and flogged, spit upon, cursed, made to carry his own cross. And then he was put to death, one of the most horrific forms of execution ever conceived of. Jesus died on the cross that day, and he was buried in a tomb. And not very many people will argue with those events. Some people don't believe that Jesus ever existed, but most people, even other religions, will call Jesus a great man, a great teacher, even a prophet who was unfairly put to death. But what anyone who is not a believer of Jesus will argue with is that Jesus is alive and well today and sitting at the right hand of God. Because 3 days after he was buried in the tomb, Jesus conquered death itself when he rose from the grave. Everything else that happened to Jesus is something that people have little trouble believing in because it fits with our understanding of the world that we live in. But a dead man rising from the grave after being dead for 3 days doesn't fit with what we know about our world at all. But the resurrection of Jesus isn't just a neat story that we tell, a holiday that we celebrate. It is at the heart of everything that we believe in as Christians. Everything it means to be a disciple of Jesus is wrapped up in the fact that Jesus rose from the grave. Bringing the dead back to life is at the core of what Christianity is all about. Paul tells us in Romans chapter 3 that all of us are guilty of sin. No one is immune from sin and its consequences. And Paul tells us in Romans 6, the wages of sin is death. What we have earned for the sin in our lives is death. It's a Greek word that doesn't just mean the death of our bodies, but also a final spiritual death, the ultimate condemnation for our sin. The life that we were created to live by God has been extinguished by our sinfulness. The image of God that we were created in has been marred and hidden away by the sin each one of us carries. And the relationship that God created us to have with him, that he desires to have with every one of us, is impossible because of our sin, because we are sinful people. Ezekiel gives us an incredible picture of God putting his spirit within us so that we can live this new life that God calls us to and shows us what that new life would look like. But before God can put his spirit in us, God has to do a miracle in us first. In Ezekiel 36, he says, and I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. Before God can work in our hearts, before he can do anything in us to make us new, before the Holy Spirit can dwell in us and begin to do all that he does within us, God first has to take out our hearts of stone, our dead hearts, and give us a heart that is alive. He brings us back to life. Before God does this miracle in us, our hearts are dead, unliving, cold things of stone. We are unable to know the love of God, unable to respond to his love, unable to attain the kind of righteousness and holiness that we have to be able to be with God and have the relationship that he created us to have. The good news of the gospel is that God sent his son to die for us while we were still sinners, while we were still in that state, even when we didn't deserve it, even while we were spiritually dead because of our sin, Jesus died for us, and he gave us new life, brought us back to life together with him. In Colossians 2, Paul says, "And you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross." Paul uses the language of paying off a debt here. Our debt has been paid in full by the death of Jesus on the cross. Jesus took all of our sins upon himself. He bore them all the way to the cross and nailed them to the cross there with himself. He paid the penalty that we deserved for our sin. Jesus hung on the cross for 6 hours. And then John 19 tells us, when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. The word that Jesus spoke on the cross, "it is finished," is the Greek word teleo, which means to complete or to accomplish or to fully pay. Jesus paid the debt that we owed in full to show us his unconditional love and his amazing grace. The cost that he had to bear was unimaginable. But that's how great the love of God is for every single one of us. For him, it was worth all the pain, all the humiliation, all the suffering of the cross so that you and I could be free of our sin and spend eternity with him. Jesus loved each one of us so much that he endured the penalty of our sin so that we would not have to. I love the way that Paul writes, and it's actually in keeping with the rest of Scripture as well. But when Paul tells us about this problem of sin that we have, which he does pretty often, he always immediately talks about the way that God has worked through Jesus to save us from it. If you go read through Romans, he does that over and over again. When he tells us that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God in Romans 3, or that the wages of sin is death in Romans 6, the very last part of the very same verse is all about how God overcame that sin and death for us in Jesus and gives us life instead. Over and over again, in just a couple of sentences, Paul summarizes the whole gospel, and he does that in Colossians 2, where he tells us that we are dead in our sin, but God brought us back to life together with Jesus. He forgave all our sin and paid the penalty for our sin on the cross. He does the same thing in Ephesians 2. He says, and you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even while we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Jesus Christ. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. I love verse 4 here. Paul talks about how we are dead in our sins. We have walked in the ways of the world in sinful ways, gone after evil instead of after God. We were on the wrong side. We were headed for condemnation. We were dead in our sins. Paul lays out this dire, grim situation we were in. We had no way out, no way to fix it. And Paul reminds us again that we are dead, spiritually dead, because of our sin. But then Paul moves us into telling us what God has done to solve this problem. And it's like he was saying, before you lose hope, before you just give up, you have to hear what God has done for you, what God did to fix this situation that you could never fix. You have to hear the way God loves you and saved you, even though you don't deserve it. It says, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. Now, God didn't do this because we deserved it at all. None of us are worthy. None of us deserved it. He didn't do it because we earned it. In fact, Paul makes a point to tell us no one can earn grace. He didn't save us because we were worthy of it or because we were lovable. But God did all of this for us because he is rich in mercy and he loves us with a great love that we do not deserve. And because of that great love for us, because of his great mercy, he gave us new life in Christ. God did that for us because of his great love for us, and it was possible because of what Jesus did for us on the cross. In Romans 5, he says, "But God shows his great love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life." We are justified. We are made righteous in God's eyes only through the blood of Jesus. We are saved by Jesus from the wrath of God, from that eternal condemnation that we deserve because of our sin. God loved us so much, he came after us and he saved us through Jesus even while we were still sinners and the enemies of God. Paul goes on to talk about how sin came into the world through Adam, but far from blaming Adam for our sinfulness, Paul reminds us that we all sin and we are all guilty. But then he says, the result of God's gracious gift is very different from the result of that one man's sin. For Adam's sin led to condemnation, but God's free gift leads to our being made right with God, even though we are guilty of many sins. For the sin of this one man, Adam, caused death to rule over many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace and his gift of righteousness. For all who receive it will live in triumph over sin and death through this one man, Jesus Christ. I love the way that Paul says that here. All who receive this wonderful gift of God's grace and his gift of righteousness, we will live in triumph over sin and death only through Jesus. Jesus' victory over sin and death is not just his victory, but through Jesus, we get to live in triumph over sin and death as well. Jesus gave us a life that we could never have had without his great love for us. We were made alive again because of his gift. But his death was not enough to accomplish that. And here's the thing you have to know about Jesus and about what we believe about him, about Christianity. The resurrection of Jesus that we celebrate today is at the heart of everything that we believe. Without the resurrection of Jesus, nothing else that we believe matters. Jesus' teachings had an impact on the world that Jesus lived in. They have an impact on our world today. Jesus' ministry was important. He was a rabbi and a teacher. He helped people understand and follow God. He ministered to people that everyone else ignored. He spent time with people everyone else looked down upon. His miracles showed his power, the power of God, to the people that he ministered to. He helped those who had been sick or crippled for years, sometimes their entire lives. He even helped those who suffered from leprosy, people that no one else would even touch because they were unclean. Jesus' death was an incredible sacrifice, and he suffered through so much, endured so much suffering for our sake. But not his teachings, his miracles, or even his death would matter at all if Jesus never rose from the grave. All the people who say that Jesus was just another man, that he was just another great teacher, or people who call him a prophet, but nothing more. If Jesus never rose from the grave, that's all Jesus would be. They would be right. Without the resurrection, that's all Jesus would be, is another great man. Paul talks about this in 1 Corinthians 15. And he says, if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. Paul says if Jesus never rose from the dead, if he's still in his grave and we're wrong, well, then we who believe in Jesus are ignorant fools. If he's still in his grave, we're still in our sins. There's no new life to be had. And if he's still in his grave, we have no hope of eternity. Paul says if that's true, we should be pitied more than anybody else. But thankfully, he goes on. He says, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Because Jesus did indeed rise from the dead, we who believe in Jesus have found the way, the truth, and the life. Because Jesus rose from the grave, we have been washed clean of our sinfulness and have been clothed in the righteousness of Jesus instead. Because Jesus rose from his grave, we have an unshakable hope that we will enjoy eternity with Jesus, where there will be no more sin, no more pain, no more sorrow, and no more death. Without exception, the greatest event in all of history is when Jesus stepped out of his tomb, never to die again. And because Jesus lives, so also we can live. Because Jesus lives forevermore, we can live with him for eternity. Because of God's rich mercy, his great love for us, and the amazing grace of Jesus, we who were dead in our sins have been made alive together with him. And today we celebrate because Jesus gave us that gift of amazing grace that is free to us, but cost Jesus everything he had to give. Today we celebrate because Jesus brought us back to life when we were dead in our sins. We celebrate because Jesus changed everything when he rose from the grave. Jesus won the victory over sin and death and brought us hope that can never be taken away from us. His victory is our victory as well. In his great love for us, Jesus died to give us the grace that we so desperately need, each and every one of us. And so now the choice is up to us. Whether we live for all eternity in the presence of God, the God who gave his life for us, or separated from God, it all depends on what you do with this great gift of love and grace that Jesus has given to you. And the choice is yours. What will you do with Jesus and his grace? I'm going to invite the worship team to come back up. We always offer a few invitations here at Agape. And the first is that if you have never given your life to Christ, if you have never put your faith in him and trusted in him as your Lord and Savior, it is the most important decision you could ever make. And we encourage you to make that decision today. If you've never trusted in Jesus, don't wait another day. He's the one that gave you life that you can never have on your own. And if you don't have that, you don't have anything. So if you need to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, then please come and do that. If you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, but you've never been baptized, we believe that's an important part of publicly declaring that we now belong to Jesus and putting our faith and our trust in him. And so if you need to be baptized, we would love to help you do that as well. If you're a baptized believer in Christ and you're looking for a place to belong, a church home, to be built up and encouraged in your faith as you walk toward Christ, we would love to have you be a part of this family where we can do that together. If you need to make any of those decisions, you can come up during this next song. If you've got questions about that, please come and talk to me. Come and talk to Taylor. Go and talk to one of our elders after service. We'll be at the doors as you leave. So if you have questions, please let us know. We'll help you with those.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. You would take my place. Bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing all that you've done for me. Thank you.
Would you pray with me? Lord, we are so thankful for today. We're so thankful for a day that we can come together and worship you and lift up praises to your name for who you are and for what you have done for us. And Lord, this gift of incredible, amazing grace that you have given us by giving your life on the cross is just overwhelming. Lord, the fact that you did that, not just for all of humanity, but for me and for every one of us individually standing in this room because you loved each and every one of us so much, is overwhelming. Lord, we are in awe of your love and your grace and your mercy and how far you went to make sure that we could be free of our sin and that you could bring us new life. Lord, as we celebrate your resurrection, we so look forward to the day that we can live with you for eternity in a place with no more sin or pain or death or sorrow. Lord, until that day, help us to live as faithful followers of yours who show that amazing grace and love to the world around us. In your name, amen.